Now we Beachpoint, how are we doing today? Merry Christmas season. I guess I could say Merry Christmas, right? It works for the whole thing. We're so excited that you're here today. I know you probably all have a lot on your plate, so thanks for choosing to be here worshiping together this morning. If this is your first time, a special welcome to you. We are so glad you've decided to join us. And there's a card in front of you in the pew, or there'll be a QR code on the screen. We would just love to get to know you, get to know your name, get to know your face. And you can turn in that card at the Connect card outside. Kim would love to shake your hand, give you a hug, and very enthusiastically welcome you here this morning. And even if this isn't your first time and you have a prayer request, there's a team who would love to pray for you. And on that Connect card, actually, there's a section for prayer requests. So if you didn't know that, that's a great thing to utilize if you're in a season and you need some prayer warriors behind you. But here we are in this first Sunday of Advent. I can't believe we're at the end of the year already. It feels like 2023 just started. But here we are. And, you know, we sing, here we pull out the Christmas songs. They're very familiar melodies, very familiar lyrics. But I want to encourage us as we sing another Christmas song this morning, not to just get lost in the autopilot, not to just kind of let our muscle memory take over, but to actually not lose focus that God, that Jesus is the reason that we're singing these songs in the first place, right? So with that in mind, let's sing another Christmas song.
morning and welcome. My name is Sarah French and I am the Family Ministry Admin here at Beach Point. And we just wanted to thank you for joining us today, whether you're online or here in person. And here at Beach Point Church, this month we have a special chance to make a difference for those who are hurting and in need in and around our community. We are asking for your help to unleash compassion this Christmas. Through Project Hope, we are committed to assisting some of the most vulnerable families in our cities and across the globe. By collaborating with our mission partners, both locally and globally, we can bring blessings to families and accomplish meaningful projects in the upcoming year. During this season of giving, we are asking for you to consider how the Holy Spirit might be inviting you to join us in making a difference. Just last night, I went on our Beach Point app and I clicked on Project Hope to see how our family could help a local family this year. And by the time I finished reading through each of the stories of people who live right here in our community, I was in tears. These families have gone through so much, and many of them are taking brave and scary steps to ensure a better future for them and their children. And by simply donating or purchasing them new items on their list, we can help them on that journey towards a better future. So, if you haven't had a chance yet, grab some tissues and go to beachpoint.com or go on the Beach Point app and read through the stories and see how you might be able to help. And if you decide to donate money towards the purchasing of new items, you can do that through the Beach Point app, through the website, through the QR code, or we have Project Hope envelopes in the pew racks in front of you. And if you choose to use the envelopes, you can drop those off in the offering boxes in the back of the room. If you are bringing in items, it's really important that you bring them in by next Sunday. Otherwise, you can be a part of Project Hope throughout the entire month by donating all month long, donating monetary gifts. So your gracious contributions, whether it be the monetary donations or the purchasing of new gifts, will be greatly appreciated and will make a significant impact in our community this Christmas. And speaking of Christmas, it's already December. Can you guys believe it? So make sure to plan ahead and check out our Christmas service times. This year, we're going to have four services to choose from. So first, we're going to have our Christmas Eve service on December 23rd at 4 p.m. And not only are we going to have a wonderful service, but afterwards, we're going to have free concession stands with really yummy food, a hot chocolate bar, fun activities for the whole family. And this service is my favorite service and the one that my family loves to attend. But then on Sunday, December 24th, at 9 a.m., we will be having a traditional service here, as well as a contemporary service at 11 a.m. And all of those services that I've mentioned so far, the 23rd at 4 p.m., the 24th at 9 a.m., and the 24th at 11 a.m., will have kid programming during those services. Our fourth Christmas service will be Sunday, December 24th at 4 p.m., and there will not be kids programming, but your kids are more than welcome to join us here in service. And if you're anything like me, and the only thing you remember about what I just said is something about yummy food and hot chocolate, you can go to beachpoint.com and all of the service information is there. And lastly, with it being the first Sunday of the month, we partake in communion, which will be happening toward the end of our time together. If you're joining us online, we want to encourage you to take a moment and gather your things for your moment of communion. Once when my family was watching online, we got out our fancy glasses and got some root beer and Hawaiian rolls, and it was delicious. For us here in person, we do not have root beer and Hawaiian rolls, but you should have received your communion elements on your way into the worship center on the patio. If you find yourself without these elements, please raise your hand and an usher will bring them to you. And you guys can go ahead and have a seat and I'm gonna pray. Father, we come before you thankful and grateful for the opportunity to gather together and worship today. as we enter into this new month and this time of celebrating your perfect love coming down to earth in flesh as your son Jesus, let us pause, reflect, and take a breath. Jesus, in the midst of the to-do lists, gift exchanges, school events, parties, decorating, and keeping our treasured family traditions going, help us to stop and remember you in all we do. Help us be generous as we seek to unleash compassion in our community through Project Hope. Help us spread the joy of knowing our God loves us so much that he sent his only son to live among us. And help us, Lord, in all we do, to do it for your glory and honor. Jesus, you are indeed our mighty King, and it is in your name we pray. Amen.
Shall not fade, amen. Like his blood in the hands.
you are so worthy to be glorified. You are so worthy of every breath we take, every word that we say. God, that you are an almighty king who chose to humble himself and to give the greatest sacrifice of the one that you loved most for us, God. May we not lose sight of that this season. Would we not get distracted from that? And Lord, this is our prayer for this December and for 2024, God, that we would put you at the center and keep you at the center, God. We pray this in your beautiful and powerful name, Jesus. We pray. Amen. You can feel free to grab a seat.
Right. Well, it is Christmas time, and many of you realize this because all of your senses are telling you at the same time that it's Christmas time. So your eyes are seeing it. You're seeing things like lights and decorations and cool Christmas t-shirts and sweatshirts, and everything that you're looking at is telling you that Christmas is coming. What are you looking forward to seeing? What Christmas sights do you love to see that are your traditions? Your tongue is telling you it's Christmas time. When you taste a peppermint mocha or eggnog or whatever it is, that baked good that you look forward to only at this time of year, and your sister makes some kind of Oreo cookie thing that, I don't know, just please set an extra amount aside for me because they're my favorite ones all year long. But those things that come once a year, what flavors are you looking forward to tasting this season? Your ears hear it, right? As we sing the carols, as we start singing songs that you're like, oh, I've waited all year to sing this song, and you kind of hold on with anticipation to sing it, but we start hearing things. You hear the jingling of bells everywhere, all kinds of things. What sounds do you love to hear at Christmas time? And your nose smells it with evergreen trees, with cinnamon, whatever is baking breads and cookies and cakes and all kinds of goodies. There's so many ways in which your nose is telling you it's Christmas time. What aromas do you love to smell at Christmas? Everything. All of our senses are saying it's Christmas time, but there's kind of most of the world has like a Buddy the Elf kind of feeling of anticipation, right? That Santa's coming, right? Everyone's excited about that, right? You know that, Allie. But for us, as Sandra shared, this is also a season in which we in the church, we call it Advent. There is a sense of, for us, of longing and anticipation, of waiting for the arrival of Christ into the world. Advent is simply a word that means coming or arrival. And this season in the church is a season in which we long for the one who would bring to us hope and love and joy and peace. That we join in this. And this first week of this time is a season of hope in which we find ourselves in darkness and in struggle. And we are longing for the one who will come and lead us out. This season, our series is called No Other Name. And we want to point you to the names that are given to this child who is born. The ways that he will be called, certain titles, that he is a wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, a Prince of Peace, that he will be called Emmanuel, that we are to give him the name Jesus. All of these names are packed with meaning and purpose, and they tell us something about the way that God cares about us and the way that God is reaching out to us. But today I want us to lean into one of the titles that is given to Jesus, and it's the title of Son of the Most High God. So this morning, one of my hopes for you is that you will begin the Christmas season understanding the bigness of what God is doing. That the Son of the Most High God has come into the world, has come for you. And what I want you to see is that he has not come on his own adventure to experience the world. He has come on a mission. This is our big idea, that the Son of God has come to rescue us. The Son of God, the Son of the Most High God, has come and entered into our pain and our distress. He's entered in to conquer sin and death and hell and all these things that we cannot conquer for ourselves. And so when we think about the Bible and some of the descriptions, we hear things like this. John will say, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. That God is reconciling the world through Christ Jesus, that he's not going to count their sins against them. This is big, right? Remember, we saw this as we began in the book of Ephesians, that we are dead, that we are lost, that we are under the power and control of the ruler of this world. But God sent his Son for us. This is what we want to lean into on this first Sunday, is to see the bigness of the Son of God, the Son of the Most High has come for us. So let me invite you to turn to Luke chapter 1, and we're going to look at Luke's description. What I want to draw your attention to this morning is when we read the story of Mary, we're often drawn into Mary, and we're going to think about her for a moment because I think there's a wonderful application of her life. But don't miss the announcement that the angel is making about who it is who's coming into this world. This season in which all these stories are told comes after a long season of silence, 400 years since the last prophet has spoken. And now God is speaking into the world what he's about to do. And for Mary and Joseph, you're talking about two young people from a small little town that nobody would know about. They're not people who stand out. They're people who most likely grew up together in this little town. They played together as kids, and somewhere along the line, their parents decided this would be a good match, and they were matched together. They were betrothed, which is something we don't have, but betrothal was a formal commitment. The village would have come together. There was a big celebration. It was like being married, but you're not married yet. It was so formal and permanent that the only way to break betrothal was to get a divorce. And we'll see this coming when we look at Joseph's story. But the idea is simply that they are committed together. But they are, during this season, it would be normal for Joseph to kind of prepare things. They would not be together alone very much during this time. There was to be no funny business. There was kind of a protection that would go over this time. And you'll kind of sense that a little bit in Mary's response. But the wedding is still to come. They have their plans laid out. They have their life laid out. And then the angel shows up. Verse 26, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." And Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "Well, how will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." And then the angel left her. This passage about the birth of Jesus reminds us, one, that God is keeping his promise. The son in David's line, both Mary and Joseph are in the line of David. This promised Messiah, this promised son is going to come. The preparations are being made. We see even in the pregnancy of Elizabeth that there is a plan, this miracle birth that is going to happen of John, that this means that the one who will prepare the way is coming as well. And that the purpose of God will not be stopped. Nothing from God will ever fail. What feels impossible for us is not impossible for God. Now, I don't know about you, I've always been somewhat drawn into Mary, her humility, and her desire to serve the Lord. And I do think it's genuine humility, because her question is very real, and it's very raw, and it's very honest. And it's very different than Zechariah. So if you know the story right before this of Elizabeth and Zechariah, the story of their miracle pregnancy, they're an older couple, they can't conceive. And then as Zechariah is serving as priest, the angel comes and talks about their miracle pregnancy. Zechariah says, I want to be sure of this. Can you give me a sign? And the angel says, "You really, that's what you want? All right, here's a sign." And he's mute for the next 9 months. That's just a reminder to you who like to ask God for signs. You better think before you ask for a sign. He might just give you one. But Mary's question is, it's a real question. She is young. She's a teenager. She is asking a real question. I don't know a lot about biology, but I know enough about how this is supposed to work. The math doesn't add up. And so there is some description of how this is going to happen. But Mary's ultimate response doesn't show that she lacks any kind of faith. It just shows that she lacks understanding. And she is willing to give herself to this plan. I don't know that she ever totally understood exactly how it was all going to play out, but she is committed to the plan. And the depth of her commitment is so beyond her years in so many ways. I think all of us see this. What better response to give God than to say to God, "I am your servant. That I want your purposes to be fulfilled through my life." And Mary is not just saying yes to a pregnancy. She's saying yes to a scandal. Because it will, as she begins to go through this experience, it will be very clear that something happened. And the story that this is God's baby is not going to fly very well. She doesn't even know how Joseph is going to respond. She is giving herself over to scandal. She's given herself over not just to a delivery, but she's given herself over to motherhood. She's going to raise this child. She's giving years, decades of her life to this. And she is giving away her plans. Whatever plans her and Joseph have, as young and ambitious as they are, maybe as simple as they are, their plans have now been exchanged for God's plans. But I think verse 32 gives us some understanding of why she is willing to make such a commitment. This is a special birth. This is a birth that requires sacrifice. John will be great in the sight of others, but in the sight of God, but he is great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. He's a son of David. Both Mary and Joseph are in that line, but he is a son of God. God is his father. And Luke does something very interesting. From this moment on, Luke will continue to show Jesus responding and living out his life. And what we see is that he's not just this prophet. He's not just this wise speaker or teacher. That he is someone different. He is the Son of the Most High God. That with him, nothing is impossible. So here's the first thing I want you to see as we look at this title, Son of the Most High God, is that Jesus can rescue you from whatever is holding you back in this life. Jesus can rescue you from whatever is holding back in this life. Luke will continue to show that problem after problem, challenge after challenge, struggle after struggle, when people encounter Jesus, he can lead them out of that by trusting in him. Nothing in this life, and I mean nothing, nothing has power over him. One of the examples comes in Luke chapter 4. It says this, that at sunset, the people brought to Jesus all who had various kinds of sickness, and laying his hands on each one, he healed them. Moreover, demons came out of many people shouting, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak because they knew he was the Messiah. Luke says every sickness, everything in life that needs healing was brought to Jesus and he could handle it. Every struggle, everything that holds us back, every power, every evil power that comes in contact with him knows very clearly who he is and calls out Jesus, Son of God, or Jesus, Son of the Most High. They know how big he is. And whatever struggle it is that we are facing, Jesus can handle it. This is why I think, remember, the angel says this comment that no word from God will ever fail to Mary. And some of your Bibles may be translated this way, that there is nothing will be impossible with God. Luke 1:37, nothing will be impossible with God. When I was a young Christian, this was one of my very first memory verses. I was a high school kid trying to figure out how to live life with God. And this became kind of a go-to memory verse to not be afraid of whatever it was that I was facing. And I think you know this too. Sometimes the healing and the unraveling of our struggles happens quickly. And sometimes it takes time. It's a process. But there's nothing too big for him. Nothing is impossible for him. So what feels impossible this Christmas? What feels like there's no way out? There's no other path. There's no way forward. Nothing is impossible with God. Jesus, he has not promised us a challenge-free life, but he has promised to be in it with us. For some of us, it feels like the story in Luke 8 of the storm. And it feels like our life is a storm and Jesus is asleep, not paying attention. Right? And I love Rembrandt's painting. You get this sense of the drama and the power. Remember this storm that comes up and they wake him up. Don't you care that we're all going to die? And Jesus rebuking their little bit of faith, they don't have enough faith of what they've seen already. Jesus does, I mean, how would you know he was going to do this? But he stands up in the boat and it says he rebukes the wind and the waves. Imagine being in that boat and he just simply says, "Quiet, enough." And the wind dies down and the waves die down. And you're like every other disciple going, who is this? Who does this? Who tells wind and waves to stop? And they do. Jesus stands in the midst of the storms of our life and he says, quiet, enough. So what challenges are you up against? As the season begins, what challenges are you up against? What storm are you stuck in this Christmas? It can feel like Jesus is asleep, but nothing is impossible with God. Lee Strobel, some of you know this name. He used to be actually a writer with the Chicago Tribune. He was not a believer in God at the time. And he was writing a story about some of the poorest families in the Chicagoland area. And he came across this family called the Delgados. He visited their apartment. It was a grandmother, Perfecta, and her two granddaughters. One was 11, one was 13. He walked in their apartment. There was really nothing in the apartment except a kitchen table and a jar of rice. The two girls each had one dress, and they had one sweater that they would share between them. So any of you who've been to Chicago can imagine what it's like to walk to school. They'd walk to school halfway. They'd switch sweaters to the shivering sister, and the other would wear it the other side, other way. And so he wrote a story about them and what they were facing. But one of the things that he was surprised about when he encountered them was, here was a grandmother crippled by arthritis, unable to work, yet continually spoke so confidently about her faith in Jesus. She had faith and she had hope. She was convinced that Jesus had not abandoned them. And he said, I'd never sensed in them despair or self-pity. Instead, there was this feeling of hope and peace. He wrote the article about them, and then he moved on to other assignments. But he couldn't shake the idea of what he had encountered, who these people were. On Christmas Eve day, he found himself thinking of this family again. Thinking, here's a family who has nothing but faith. They are happy. I have everything, and I'm miserable. And so he went to visit them. He went back over to their house, and when he opened the door, he was amazed at what he saw. His readers had responded. The house was filled. There were gifts, there was furniture, there was food, there were thousands of dollars, and there were dozens of winter coats for the two girls. And he was amazed at the outpouring that he saw. But what really impressed him was what he was interrupting. Perfecta and her granddaughters were preparing to give away most of what they had received. They were thinking about their neighbors. They were thinking about those who are around them. And he asked them, what are you doing? And in her broken English, she said, our neighbors are still in need. We have plenty. They have nothing. This is what Jesus would want us to do. He said he was blown away by this. And she was gesturing towards the gift. She says, these are wonderful. These are very good. We did not do anything to deserve these gifts. These are gifts from God. But she said, this is not his greatest gift. No, that's what we celebrate tomorrow. His greatest gift is Jesus. Strobel went on to become a believer. And he wrote a book called The Case for Christmas, and in it he writes this about this experience. He says, to her, the child in the manger was the undeserved gift that meant everything. More than material possessions, more than comfort, more than security. And at that moment, something inside of me wanted desperately to know this Jesus. Because in a sense, I saw him in Perfecta and in her granddaughters. They had peace despite poverty, while I had anxiety despite plenty. They knew the joy of generosity while I only knew the loneliness of ambition. They looked heavenward for hope while I only looked out for myself. They experienced the wonder of the spiritual while I was shackled to the shallowness of the material. And something made me long for what they had. One of the reasons why I'm so excited for you to do Project Hope is you're going to, in ways that the Spirit will lead you, you are going to have your own encounters with Perfecta and families like hers, families who are trusting in God, and you will be the way in which they experience God's grace. The story of the storm is quite something, and the storms we find ourselves in. But sometimes the storm goes to something even worse. The story of the storm is pretty scary if you're one of the disciples. But the real fear comes when they actually hit the shore. And a man with no clothes who's obviously out of his mind and deranged, there's something that fills him. He has broken chains attached to him. He is his body is ripped up. He comes running after them and falls at them. And Luke 8 says this, that when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High? I beg you, don't torture me. there was this impure spirit, demons that possessed this man. He said, for Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he had been chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. And the story goes on that Jesus casts the demon out. He restores the man as only he can. He's the Son of the Most High God. And the man is so moved by what Jesus has done, the restoration of what he's done, that he asked to go with him. But when Jesus performed this miracle, he took the demons out of this man and put them in a herd of pigs, and the pigs ran off the cliff. The people of the village were so terrified by who Jesus was. Who has this kind of power over this man? Who has this power over these spirits? Who has this? And they asked Jesus to leave. And so the man said, asked Jesus, can I come with you? Can I be one of your disciples? And Jesus had a different plan in mind. Jesus said this to him. He said, return home and tell how much God has done for you. So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. The man they used to chain up was now chosen by the Son of the Most High God to be God's missionary, God's mouthpiece, God's ambassador, to tell these people about who God was and what God was doing. And if you think about this, what we see all the time in the Bible is that Jesus is always rewriting people's stories. The last chapter of this man's story is nothing but horror. But now the next chapter is one filled with promise and filled with hope. What could the next chapter of your life look like if Jesus wrote it? What would it look like for you to give the pen of your life to the Son of the Most High God and say, you have to write the next chapter for our family. You have to write the next chapter for my career. You have to write the next chapter of my life. Because me writing it hasn't led me to any kind of life, to any kind of hope, to any kind of peace. What would it look like for Jesus, the Son of the Most High God, to write the next chapter of your life? Well, I want us to prepare our hearts for communion. And as you think about communion, think about what happens in this moment. Because in this moment, from Luke chapter 9 on, everything points to the cross. Jesus has set his face towards Jerusalem, and he knows if he goes there, what awaits him. And so all throughout, the descriptions are that the Son of the Most High God will give his life. And as he does, anyone who follows has to be prepared as well to take up their cross as well. Jesus does come all the way. And just as he predicted, he is arrested, he is tried, and they ask him, are you the Son of God? And he says, yes, I am. And this response leads to his crucifixion. And he's taken out to be crucified among two thieves. And there's this amazing story that Luke wants to tell us, unique to his narrative. Is a story of Jesus being on the cross set between two thieves. Now listen, notice the difference between Jesus and everyone else in the crowd. Luke tells us this, that two other men, both criminals, were also led out to him to be executed. And when they came to the place of the skull, they crucified him there along with criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. They divided up his clothes by casting lots, and people stood there watching. And the rulers even sneered at him. They said, he saved others. Let him save himself if he's God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was a written notice above him which read, this is the king of the Jews. And one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. Everything to this moment is nothing but humiliation. It's nothing but insult. But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you're under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The scene of the cross is humiliating. It's meant for that. It's meant to send a message to anyone who would rebel. Stripped down naked, beaten, nailed to suffer, to suffocate. This is the way that the Son of God is giving his life. And in this place, everyone calling out to him, "If you are this one, save yourself." But instead, he stays there to save us. But in one of the most amazing moments is before he takes his final breath, there's this moment in which this thief calls out, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." That simple request is met with these words, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is a reminder that Jesus has rescued us from sin and for God. We are not just rescued from our sins, but we are rescued for God. This is what God wants for us, a life with him. And even in this final fantastic moment, this incredible moment where Jesus takes his final breath, there's this act, this moment where he meets this humble response. There's a Scottish pastor, he actually lives here now in America, named Alistair Begg. And he was thinking about the beauty of the cross, and he was thinking about the beauty of our salvation and what it is that the Son of God came to give his life for us. And he began to reflect on the thief on the cross and think of what an incredible story. And I could tell it for you from him, but I love his Scottish accent so much that I think it's better that he just tells it himself. So here's Alistair Begg.
"Think about the thief on the cross. And what an immense, I can't wait to find that fellow one day to ask him, how did that shake out for you? Because you were cussing the guy out with your friend. You've never been in a Bible study. You never got baptized. You didn't know a thing about church membership. And yet you made it. You made it. How did you make it?" That's what the angel must have said, you know, like, "What are you doing here?" "Well, I don't know." What do you mean you don't know?" "Well, because I don't know." "Well, you know, excuse me, let me get my supervisor." "They go get the supervisor in here." "So, we have just a few questions for you. First of all, Are you clear on the doctrine of justification by faith?" "The guy said, I never heard of it in my life." And what about, let's just go to the doctrine of scripture immediately." This guy's just staring. And eventually in frustration, he says, on what basis are you here?" And he said, "The man on the middle cross said, I can come." Now, that is the only answer.
Isn't that good? And that's our story. We've done nothing to deserve this, but the Son of the Most High God has come in and given his life for us. So what would it look like for you to put your trust in Jesus, the Son of the Most High God? What would it look like for you to turn to him this Christmas, to give him over the challenge you're facing, the storm you're in? What would it look like for him to write the next chapter of your life? What's holding you back? How is he inviting you to be a servant like Mary or the man who was sent into his village? What would it look like for you to trust him? Or maybe some of you feel like the thief on the cross. You just simply say, there's nothing I have to offer, but Jesus, would you take me too? And so I want to invite us to pray before we take communion. Would you bow together? And maybe just hold out your hands as a sign just to say, Lord, here is my challenge. Here is my storm. Here is my chapter. Here's my life. I can't do it. I can't save myself. I can't rescue myself. I can't get our family out of this. But nothing is impossible with God. You are the Son of the Most High God, and I offer my life to you. Jesus, we just praise you for that. You've come to rescue us from sin, but for God. Our lives now, abundant, eternal in you. And we praise you and we thank you. Amen. Well, as we prepare to do communion, I want you to think about the spirit of Advent, this idea of coming and arrival, of waiting. And one of the beautiful things about Advent is this: come December 26, guess what? We're still in a spirit of Advent because we are waiting on Jesus to come to us. Jesus is coming again. In fact, every time we gather together for communion, we need to think about the words that the Apostle Paul gave us, that we eat this bread and we drink this cup to remember his death until he comes again. He is coming. And our hearts are filled with anticipation. And so as you take the bread and the cup today, as you take the bread, think about Jesus, the Son of the Most High God, coming into this world, humbling himself, becoming a man, becoming a servant, giving his life and death, even death on a cross. And give him thanks for what he's done for you. But as you take the cup, I want you to think about this moment that Matthew describes, that Jesus says this interesting thing when he was doing this. The best way I can try to imagine my own mind is he has the cup and he's holding it. And he says, I'm not gonna drink from the cup of the vine until I drink it anew with all of you when the fullness of my kingdom comes. And what Jesus is doing in that time, that was making an oath, that was making a commitment to a group of people to say, I will see this through. I will not partake of this until I see this through. And Jesus is holding a cup to you and saying to you, I'm making my promise to you. I will see you through. I will be in it all the way. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I am coming for you. And in your own mind, you can try to imagine that and holding your own cup back up to him and say, I'm in too. I'm in it with you. And so when you're ready, eat, drink, remember him, and then we'll close with celebration.
Project Hope Board, if you get a chance, check out on our app or online what ways you can get involved with Project Hope and unleash compassion in our community and in our world. And if you're needing prayer this morning, we will have people here in the front of the worship center who would just be so happy to pray with you. But we pray that you'll be blessed, and we hope to see you next week.
comfortable, lift your hands, sing it out.
Here I stand, I surrender, I need you.
This is my surrender.